kept it upstairs. They left him alone. If he came down and brought that near the guard, they would beat the living hell out of this guy, charge him with assaulting the guards, and put him in DDU. It's the way they were treating people in there.
Yeah, the Norfolk, I only had one time, and it was after I had marched the prisoners around the, what would they call the quadrangle. Very different from what Walpole, like the college camper, at the quad. Well, I pulled out all the guys, 750-some-odd guys, had them five or six abreast right after dinner, and I marched them around the quad one night, and being in front and being the chairman. Well, it scared the crap out of them. Hey, what are you doing? What are you doing, Don Michael? All the guards come out, and they maybe had 25 guards. You know, we could have left the prison. Whatever. They scared them. And I said, we're just out for a walk. And I just shut. So I let them go. Yeah. So we left them go. The following night, they come on, and they call me up to the thing, and the lieutenant slammed me up against the wall. Had me alone. And when he slammed me up against the wall, I probably did one of the most disgusting things I ever did in my life. He had me up against the wall, and I said, who walks your kids to school? I thought he was going to, first I thought he wanted to kill me, but then he realized who, he didn't have a prisoner that had nobody on the outside or couldn't call, and he's thinking mafia, whatever guy, he's thinking, and he let me go. He let me go. I said, don't ever do that to me again, right? But what a horrible, I saw in his face a horrible fear by just what I said. When you could see it, you see it in his eyes. And you know, obviously it was a game and stuff like that. But it's also a scary thing. He had me alone with his guys. Mm-hmm. And if I was somebody who didn't have anybody, I was dead meat.
The culture in prison, like, you know, is constantly changing.
Yeah.
Right? So what works back here doesn't work over here. Because the dynamics have changed. I'm 70 years old. I've spent over two-thirds of my life in some form of confinement, from reform schools to state prison. In reform school, 13 years old, I learned how to steal a car. I learned how to break the antenna off the car and make a 22 rifle long zip gun. When I got to the state prison, I learned how to pick locks. I learned how to crack safes. I learned how to serve a burglars. This is what the nature of prisons are. They're wrong in concept, they're wrong in application, they're wrong to their core. All they do is produce this. I mean, when I went to Walpole, the old school taught the new school. I came in about at the end of it. There were maybe 10 hardcore drug addicts in Walpole. Nobody trusted a drug addict. Anybody that could be controlled by this couldn't be trusted.
Absolutely.
Today, 85% of the people in prison have some substance abuse.
That's what Jamie talked about.
Right. And the thing is the old school stopped teaching the new school. Right? The professional criminal is basically dead. You don't see him in the prison system. He is very, very rare to pop into the prison system. He's almost invisible. You don't even see him. He goes right through. He knows how to manipulate it and be gone. Now, and this is the thing. As the culture changes, now, after I got out of DDU, I was in the max section of Walpole, and the guards were starting at first with the child molesters and the skinners and stuff, beating them up as they come down the corridor. Now, in order for me to go to the hospital has to put my name on a list. All right? So the guard in the block gets a call, send the Lalo to the hospital. He looks at the list, my name ain't on the list. He's supposed to call, hey, you called the Lalo, his name ain't on the list. All right? That's the game to get the guy out of the door.
Yep.
All right? Now, in the corridor, let's say this is the corridor, there's a grill that goes down one-third of the corridor, and then two-thirds are opened up, and there's two rooms here, and the guards are in there. When a guy comes in here, boom, they come out and they nail him and beat him up.
Both sides.
Now, they started climbing up the scale. Right? and I had told outside people, I said, listen, let me explain something to you, what's coming. When they jump and beat up one of our people, we're going to go in the corridor and stab the living shit out of the whole crew in the corridor. We are armed in the block. We are not gonna permit them to beat us up. So what happened was Susanna Schaefer, she says, what would you do? How would you stop? I said, look, here's the problem. And I wrote the thing out. I explained that, look, when a guy gets beat up, by the time they get in there, 2 or 3 weeks have gone by, all the black and blues are gone. Mm-hmm. What?
No proof.
When we tell you that a guy just got beat up, get the hell inside the prison, bring the camera, right? They don't let you in, go get a court order, come on in and take the pictures. Grab the medical records, right? A certain group of guards are constantly beating prisoners up. Mm-hmm. And they are accusing the prisoners of assaulting them and putting them into segregation. Well, if you get these names, you'll find that they've never been injured, and the inmate is always the one that's in the hospital getting stitches. You know, there's your documentation, right? Anyway, I just aired it out, put the whole thing out there, and what's her name? Young, Rebecca Young. She was becoming a lawyer. She put out a grant for Soros and got a $50,000 grant to set up a, what's the heck's the term they used? Fast response team, right? And pretty much right away, it started slowing stuff down. Because remember, these guards are not only corrupting the guy in the block, they're corrupting the guys in the corridor, and it goes higher because they have what they call inner perimeter security. These are like the super screws, right? And other guards won't lie to these guys so they can be fired. These guys are only answerable to the superintendent. So they know what happened, and so does the superintendent. And the superintendent, under the law, is required to report any felony committed in the prison, and he doesn't. All right. So when Rebecca came in there with that stuff, I mean, they called her all kinds of names, but the assault on prisoners, right, almost to zero.
Which was the principle behind the observer program. Which was to neutralize that. I'm going to end with an absolutely fascinating story about human nature and life in general. Just happened to be at Longboat. I had to spend many nights there supervising the companies and noise of the observers and sort of being ready until things are calmed down in case I had to go in. So about the third night that I was there, I see this guy coming through the trap. You know, in the maximum security prison, there's a big steel door, and you go in, and it clangs behind you. You look up, and there's the guy with the gun. There's another steel door, that's why it's called a trap. And then they open it, and you're so this guy comes in through the trap, pushing this, you know, vending cart, like you see on the street, with a tarp over it and everything. And you know, kind of older guy. And I looked at him and I said, man, that guy looks familiar. You know, there was some very famous people in Longwood, you know, in the sense of variety. And he goes over to this one corner, and I look out the window while he's going over to the corner, and I see all these women lining up out, you know, on the outside of the prison. You know, the open area, the regular reception area. He pulls this tarp off, and there are all these
chokers.
It's fucking Boston Strangler.
Jeweler.
He made chokers.
Silky, he called them.
Silky.
And these women would come in and buy them.
Oh my God.
I just sat there. I mean, as I started talking to him, I said,
But Albert DeSalvo was not the boss.
And he wasn't the boss, right? But he was making money hand over fist.
We know that, right?
Money hand over fist. Hand over fist. And then I forget how he worked it with the car.
He died
but he had
because he was going to do an expo on F.D. Bailey.
He what?
He was going to do an expo on F.D. Bailey.
Who basically set him up.
Yep.
And also, don't forget that, that Ed Brook, who was the first black senator.
Senator, right.
We became the black senator because he got the conviction of the so-called Boston Strangler.
The two individuals that they accused of killing him were two professional.
You're right.
And Albert was in there for the longest time, no static, no problem. These guys don't kill people for the fun. They killed for the money. And they have never proved it, but let's say for the sake of argument, those two killed him, then somebody on the street, probably Bailey, paid them to kill him.
Because they knew the jig was up, the story was going to come out. But that's.
He died with $1,700 in his pocket.
At least, but I think he was making thousands of dollars each time he did it twice.
So you know it wasn't to rob him.
But to see these women come in, and I mean not a half, I mean a line, you know. I said, you know, that's interesting. That goes beyond, you know, absurd. That goes beyond anything.
Oh, now, really?
No. See, I think we did with Boston Strangler, right? They tried to accuse this other guy, George Nassar, right? There were at least four people doing killing, right? Insertion into women is a separate kind of offense versus penal penetration. The same person doesn't do both. You know what I mean? The age difference, one was nailing elderly, someone was nailing younger. Right? There was at least four different killers out there.
Yeah.
And when they pull that scam with him, with the salvo, they left four killers running loose on the street. If the salvo did the whole expo, people were going to be super, super embarrassed.
I'm on over here.
You left four murderers running loose in the streets for political crap.
And also, it was a lot of hysteria. It's a whole different thing. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.